Usually I like to leave the last session open to questions and occasionally to answers. So many people approach me privately and say, I really don't want to ask that question in public. And then when they ask it, I realize it's exactly the question that everybody's afraid to ask in public. And the only answer that would ever matter to people would be if somebody had the courage to ask it. The idea of exposing ourselves to others, of making ourselves vulnerable, perhaps fearing that we will be perceived as weaker or lesser than we would like to be perceived as, the mere fact that we would put our identity on the line to make ourselves vulnerable to other people's judgment makes it very hard for us to speak our truth. It really comes down to, why should you care what anybody thinks? Why should you care? What are you hiding and protecting that is unlike what everybody else is hiding and protecting? We're all hiding our doubt. We're all hiding our fears, our shame, our resistance, our weakness, our less than perfect aspect. And everybody's got it, everybody. We're all totally, totally caught in our fear of being seen as lesser than we want to be seen. I seem to have a habit whenever I come here of spilling stuff on my shirt and then walking around like this, trying to cover it up. And finally last night, those of you who are aware of it at the restaurant, all the brio, the juice from my meatloaf was covering the front of my shirt. And I just figured, there it is. And we ended up going to a gallery after the dinner, and there was a woman who was showing us clothes that had been made with all these splotches on it. And I said, boy, mine are from Brio. And I felt really kind of like, wear it like a badge. It's a piece of art. And you need to wear yourself like a badge. You need to be willing to expose who you are to others, to give them the courage to expose who they are to you. If you want a real sharing dialogue, if you want a true friendship in life, if you want a marriage that works, if you want a connection that really has connectivity, be yourself. And don't expect yourself to be a presentation. Don't expect it to be something that has to be well-dressed at all times and has to look a certain way at all times and has to perform in a certain way, because you will grow totally exhausted of that. You will come to a point in life where you just go, I can't do it anymore. I don't want to be a presentation. I want to be myself. I want to be who and what I am. And by then you may not have the courage to do it, so you'll just become reclusive and hidden and unsharing and not available to others or to yourself. You know, so many people succumb to their own illusion, to their own fantasy of who they should be and the presentation they want to be. I always talk about my mom, who I deeply loved, but she dressed like a teenager until she was 74. And there was no way that was going to change. She had layers of makeup, and she would not be perceived in public without makeup at all. One of the things I love about this group and most people in spiritual practice is nobody wears makeup. They just say that, well, here I am. But that only goes so far. It really does come down to taking off the outer makeup that isn't something you buy from Procter & Gamble, taking off the makeup that is your presentation, how to be perfectly perceived in the world. It's how to be imperfectly perceived. It's how to be perceived as imperfect that really matters in the end, because if people don't love you for that, at some point, if you get close enough, they're going to see that in you. They're going to know that in you. And if you're afraid they're going to walk away, that fear itself may cause that to happen. Some of you are blessed with or cursed with being beautiful. And that has its own problems, because you all know underneath that beauty is fleeting and that you are not as beautiful as you appear. And that creates another issue for people. But it all comes down to exposure. It all comes down to being profoundly honest with yourself, preferably with yourself, and then, if you can, with others, or at least another, one other, a significant other, an insignificant other. Finding a way to be you in the world is so important to really free yourself from the world. You can't free yourself from an illusory presentation without letting go of that presentation. You have to be yourself, whatever that entails. And I will tell you, based on my own experience and every human being I have ever met, that self is full of doubt, is full of struggle, afraid of pain, afraid of dying, happy to have another person touch them, connect with them, happy to be loved, happy to go to a good movie, happy to have the opportunity to be alive. And so we're all in the same bag. We're all in the same place. Every one of us, we're all working it together. And we all have questions. We all have lots and lots of questions. If nothing else, we are fundamentally composed of questions and of answers that we've created. And we know not all the answers are true. We don't believe in all the things we think we believe in. And if we do, we're afraid to have that challenged by anybody, because we spent such a long time believing in this stuff. Stating your question to the world, whether it be to a teacher, whether it be to another human being, whether it just be to God, asking inside for help to understand, for clarity, help to be you, help to be real. I can't tell you, the thing that I find to be so valuable in life is a quiet, comprehensive, compassionate honesty. Wherever you can. You can't walk around just saying your crap to the world. That's not what I mean. I mean expressing the part of you that is the most hidden, the most exposed to somebody, to someone. And then maybe allowing yourself to expose yourself to everyone, to just be truly, naturally you. What a gift. And when you meet people who are like that, you just become so relieved to know it's possible. To know you can just be authentically uncertain, authentically lost, and still making your way through the world. It's really beautiful. So, having said all that, and I know this won't change things all that much, anyone who has a question, please let me know.
It comes out of what you've been saying, but what to do with feelings of inadequacy that come up when I am teaching, leading in meditation. I don't put them there, but they come up.
One, you don't have to believe everything that comes up. You don't have to believe everything that comes up. And you can look at it and just acknowledge directly to the people you're teaching, I am uncertain about this. This is what I believe, feel, or know for myself, and I'm not certain it's an absolute truth in the world, but this is my truth, my reality, and what I experience at this moment in time. I tell everyone I let become a teacher, I say to them, go out and teach, but don't teach anybody else's philosophy. Don't teach what you've heard from me. Don't teach Rudy's work. Teach what you know from your experience as honestly and openly and lovingly as you can, and allow yourself to be wrong and allow yourself to be imperfect. That alone will make the message go deep. When you do it with certainty, people always react to certainty with a certain kind of, why doesn't that feel right? Why don't I feel that? Why don't I really believe that? They have their resistance to your certainty. You know, my nephew is a born-again Christian, Jewish born-again Christian, whose whole mission in life is to turn me and everybody else into the one and only way. And every time I'm around him, and I love this guy enormously, I have to grit my teeth when that thing starts to come up, because I don't trust anybody who has the answer, because I know nobody really does. Nobody really does. They have an answer for themselves, and I love that he's found it for himself. He is really happy in his life. Beautiful children, beautiful wife, beautiful community. I am not going to be part of that community, and I don't need to be brought into it in order to be saved or to be joyful in my life. I'm happy for him. We teach from what we know. And leave it at that.
I think I'm going to be playing a clip of what you just said over and over again. Because I was kind of walking around today thinking, oh, I should have this down by now. I'm too embarrassed to ask about this. But when I'm engaging in like a long period of meditation, like I remember when we used to do like a day meditation at the ashram, or like this weekend, I find my emotions just sometimes bursting up, and I actually started crying during the lunch break at nothing. And I just wondered, is there something I can do to stop that?
No. Why would you? Why should it not be that?
Well,
why should it not be
crabby.
What?
I was being kind of crabby.
Is crabby an inhuman bad thing to be? It's part of the whole, it's part of the experience of being human. There's this thing of radical acceptance, you know, this thing of just going yes to the what is. Crabbiness comes up, anger comes up, hostility comes up, love comes up, it all keeps happening. You don't sit and curse the sky every time a cloud goes in front of the sun, although you may tomorrow. You know? Tomorrow's the eclipse, by the way, the American eclipse. And you want to be able to see it, and if you can't see it, people will be pissed because they're going to drive lots of miles to look at it. You know, life doesn't cooperate all the time, and you have a reaction to that. And that reaction is completely human. And if people are in the path of the eclipse and they can't see it, you're going to have miles and miles and miles of angry people and little children going, why can't I see it? Where is it? You told me there was going to be an eclipse. Everyone's going to be miserable, and that's going to go right through the atmosphere, and you'll drive home with it. It's human. It's real. It's part of what we are. Emotion comes up. If you are really still inside, the things that hold emotion in place and in check, which, believe me, are muscle structures that we build in so that we don't walk around crying all the time, or laughing all the time, or being inappropriate all the time. We have all these things that lock us into this personality that we are, and if you relax, the stuff comes up. Emotion comes up out of nowhere. And instead of saying, it shouldn't be like that, or I don't want that, you look at it and go, of course, I freed it. I freed it into experience, into expression. I've allowed it to be. And when emotion rises up, it goes out, it really frees you. We're all bottled up. Every person I know is bottled up emotion. Every person is waiting to, I don't know about explode, because I'm not an explosive guy, but my brother's an explosive guy. You know, give him an opportunity to explode, and it's terrifying. It's really terrifying. And I look at him, and I go, better that he keeps this stuff down, you know, because if he was living this all the time, it would be untenable. On the other hand, if it does free, if it does go up and go out, and you can really let it go, you've become liberated from a certain kind of emotion. If this stuff is constantly burning inside you over and over and over, well, you may want to go visit the site of the furnace and figure out what's fueling this thing. Why is it fueled all the time? Where is it coming from? It may be something your mother said to you when you were four, and you keep shoveling that into the same furnace and it keeps causing a fire that's impossible to deal with. And every so often, one, you know, your daughter or somebody says something and the whole furnace explodes in their face, you know, and this thing comes out. And then you go right back to shoveling stuff in that furnace. At some point, you have to sit very quietly, and meditation allows this. You go right to the source of the furnace and you go, why am I still shoveling this stuff in the furnace? Enough, enough. I see what's happening, done. And it's really powerful. This quiet little voice in you has unbelievable capacity to dampen and stop stupid behaviors that were started when you were too young to know better. And then you become free of it. You're not caught in it. And that's really valuable. But you won't know that stuff's there if you don't get quiet enough to see it rise up, or real and honest enough to see it come up and express it to people. You don't have to express it with rage. You don't have to express it with hostility. It can be honest. Honest expression to another person, if that's what it is, if it's directed at somebody else, or at God. But keep it honest. You know, this is what I feel. And don't be ashamed, because every element of emotional life is part of the human experience. Everything. And it's only by going okay to it that you can allow it to be and get freed of it. It's the stuff you're afraid of and ashamed of and don't want to let anybody know you have these feelings. That's the hard part. You know, walking around with that for a lifetime, and people do, and they're on their deathbed still holding this stuff in place. Not happy experience, you know? And I will postulate that as you die or as you are dead and your soul starts to unleash, all the stuff you've been hiding and have locked up and kept away from the world becomes visible to the infinite universe. A horrible time to become suddenly visible for you, as long as there's an idea of you. And that's when they rip you apart. That's hell. You know, hell is having to expose you to an unforgiving space. Get rid of it. Do it now. Allow it to happen now. Better to do it in front of a group. Better to do it in a room like this where people are somewhat forgiving and embracing than to do it in a hostile space where people will laugh and scorn and make it even worse. Okay? Now I scared everybody. Any other questions?
So, every so often I remember that when I have a question that I keep asking, I say, I'm not really asking it. I need to sit down and ask it. And almost invariably, there's some sort of answer. The answer might be just a sense of relief or a sense of connection or something. So, I'm wondering if you could say something about that, and I guess I'm wondering about my relationship with you. So, I've been feeling more as I've been getting older that I first need to look inside before I ask. But there's
I really agree with you. Why ask a teacher a question when you have all the answers? You know, I mean, really, in the end, you have the answers. But sometimes putting it out there, really, among other things, gives it a clarity that you might not find coming up directly in yourself at that moment. And asking a question often is the thing that helps everybody else in the room. So sometimes it's valuable to ask the question and just spare yourself the effort of having to go in and get it for yourself. On the other hand, ultimately, I do believe every question is within, and the answers are all within, and you will get what you need. But I will tell you what happens. I look at everybody in this room, and I see pockets of questions in every head that I look at. I'm seeing questions, unasked questions, and not only are they unasked of me, they're unasked of yourself. You're all sitting there holding this stuff in play, going, I don't want to ask that. or not even allowing it to come into that much focus. But there's so much really profound, deep questioning in everybody. And if it doesn't find a voice, if it doesn't find an expression, it just sits in there and does something to your insides. It's hard. It's hard walking around doubting, not certain, wondering. And yes, a lot of the things that you doubt and question and wonder about will resolve themselves over time. They will. And the answers will arise at some point if you're truly seeking them. But given the opportunity to address yourself, in this case, through this being here, it's a good thing to advantage yourself of that. I'm not trying to force anybody into a question, but I am trying to create an atmosphere where you realize that by asking, you do something for yourself and for everybody. And it's wonderful to know that you can be, bless you, that you can be exposed and acknowledged.
I went to California in the beginning of this month, and I was there. It was a 7-day trip, and it was tough because I was visiting my sister, who's not easy. And I always bring a friend with me who knows the family for protection, and it works. It works really well. So on the 6th day, we had to go so far out in the wilderness area. So we went to Reading, where we could catch the flight the next day. And we got there at, say, 5:30. We'd been driving all day, roads that you want to just get out and throw up on the side of the road because it's horrible. So I made the reservation. Somebody suggested the hotel. It was eco-friendly and all that. So I made the reservations. I go and check in. I get my room key. You know, we get our room key. We're going to go in the room. And my friend and I, and my niece was still there. She drove us there. And when I got there, I realized, my niece says, oh, it's the second floor. Well, we're looking at, I'm hungry, I'm tired, I'm crabby. And I was like, I threw a hissy fit. But it was at nobody. It was just, I was mad. And my friend, who I know forever and love her dearly, she attacked me for getting mad. And I have to say, we resolved it. It wasn't pretty, but it's funny. I hold in my heart the resentment for not being allowed to be angry.
Yeah, no, it's a cultural.
I don't even know how to say it to her. Like, that's, I was angry over hunger, tired, but when she attacked me, it was like too much.
Well, I have this feeling that if you said to her what you just said to me.
I said it to her.
Well, that's about the most you can do. That's the most you can do. Express that you feel bad, that you didn't have the right to express your anger.
No, and then she started attacking me like personal, and it was like.
Yeah, welcome.
And I was like, wait a second, why are you personalizing this? This is, I'm tired and hungry and grumpy. Leave me alone. Give me 20 minutes to blow it off. Don't pick on me. And she just, and I'm sorry, you know, it's, I just don't know what do I do with this resentment?
Eat it.
Oh, goody.
Really, okay. It'll go away.
It will eventually.
Yeah, no, if you hold that, then that's your poisoning of yourself, your own self-toxicity. You did what you needed to do, you said what you needed to do. Other people's reaction is not your problem. That's what they're going to do, it's who they are. They have to do their thing and they'll have to work it out themselves. You know, if it's threatening of the relationship, then you know, you got to talk about it. But you
she stuffed it, I'm going to deal with it, but I can see she just like put icing on that moldy cake,
yeah.
You know, so
Well, again, I'm not a therapist and I'm not going to try to deal with this therapeutically, but what you're talking about there is very real. So many people don't feel the right to express what they feel because they're going to be judged, attacked, and in some ways seen as lesser, and they hold it in and they create years and years of toxicity in themselves because they were afraid to put it out there in the world. and get rid of it. So I think an honest expression of emotion with an apology, if that's what's required, is reasonable. It's a way to go. But you have to be aware of the circumstances, aware of the person who's there. Sometimes you may have to go out in the backyard and let it out without them being there. Just let it out, you know, hit something. You know, whatever your thing is, but walking around containing all of this stuff, and then is, you know, here you are still having emotions about it, you know, it's still circulating through the system.
Well, it's actually something you said.
Well, good.
Yes.
Good. Well, let it up, let it out, I think you just did, and let it go.
Yeah.
And Rudy talks surrender. Surrender means let this stuff go. But you can't let go of the thing that's still circulating. Let it show itself, look at it, examine it, if you will, and go, bye. You don't even have to examine it. You can just let it up and out. But that's really, it's really your call. You know, we're grown-ups. We have to figure out how to manage these lives that we have. And we have to figure out how can we free ourselves of the stuff that keeps us stuck. And this stuff keeps us stuck. So be honest and real with it. And, you know, if it destroys a relationship, that would be sad. But sometimes that does happen too.
No.
But hopefully not. Okay. Thank you.
There are a lot of new faces here today, and I usually introduce myself to new people, and it popped into my head that when I was going to approach somebody, I thought I'd say, what do you call yourself, as opposed to what is your name? And I realized what a kind of deep question that is, because when I think about myself, I have this open question. Everybody else calls me Mike, but if that's who I, you know, there's a separation. And for each one of us, I guess, if you think about what you call yourself, it's not what other people call you. And engaging into a deeper introspective mindset.
But what that really talks about is being seen and known for who you are, not for the presentation, not for the label. It's really being acknowledged as a being. It rarely happens. You know, most of us are put into a category very quickly. You know, name, race, career.
Yeah.
We're just tabled very, very quickly because that's what people do. We're categorized and put into certain kinds of drawers. And every one of us wants to be heard, known, seen. Most of us. I mean, there are people who really don't, but mostly that's what we kind of hunger for. And it's rare that we get it. Creating a situation like what do you want to be called is actually kind of obtuse. It's so out there on some level that it stops the conversation. And then it might begin a dialogue, but it could also, who is this guy? What's he doing? What does he want? So it's good to master the formalities of human exchange, and then be present behind it. So that, hi, who are you? Hi, I am Michael. You know, and then you begin it. If you can do it, begin a dialogue that is so allowing and clarifying that you allow someone to look at you and go, I trust this person. And it starts to go deeper and deeper, a little bit at a time, and you start to connect in a way that is like you are sharing something remarkable of the human condition with another person.
The similarity of me giving my name to somebody and somebody else telling me their name and our career paths and all of that stuff that we perceive is sort of like the normal
It is, and it can stop there and be meaningless. You know, I mean...
Sure.
Roberta brought a friend today named Jim, who's sitting here, who I had never met before. And I didn't even give him the introductory class for this practice because I was out on a walk and they got here late, so Blanche gave it to him. So I didn't meet him until we just started eye-to-eye contact. And I met this amazing person, this really amazing human being, no story, no name. I didn't know his name. I didn't know who he was. I just saw he was with Roberta, and he was sitting there, and this thing connected, this eye-to-eye thing happened, and it was deeply acknowledging. I felt the presence of somebody who was here in this place, who was open, who was available, who was real. And after the class, we sat and started talking, and I asked his name and forgot it immediately, because I do that. But I just sat and we just started talking, and the richness of what unfolded in a process of maybe 5 minutes was so remarkable. It's the kind of thing that happens when somebody is not guarded, where you are not probing in a way that's, you know, where you're just open and gently moving into the situation, gently touching and being available to somebody to express themselves. And Jim just opened up and I felt open. And forgive me, Jim, I know we've just met, but this for me was an extraordinary idea of how you meet somebody, where you just show up together and you meet without the story, and then you fill in some of the blanks, and those blanks become like aha, 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 and it gets deeper and more beautiful. And this is someone, I don't know that I'll meet Jim again, but if I don't, I feel like I've really met somebody I really cared about. Really cared about. And it was beautiful. That's all I'm saying. It's if you're present with somebody, the thing works itself out. It reveals, it opens, it gives itself over. If they don't choose to do it, well, such is life. But it can happen. And often, the reality of another human being, if you get out of the way of judgment and out of the way of, you know, trying to be the equal of or better than or whatever, you just start to become available to them. They'll become available to you, and things happen. It's really beautiful. And you become grateful. You become grateful that you've gotten to connect with another human being. For me, that's the greatest thing ever. And I don't even mean by story. Story is interesting, but the connection with the being is amazing.
Yeah, I'm not talking about story either. It was more actually, and it's probably more for people in the class than somebody you would meet on the street to have this inside look at yourself and try and figure out who you really are.
Well, I mean, I'm not sure you figure it out so much who you really are as you become introduced to who you really are.
Right.
It's not a process of mental cognition. It's a thing of sitting quietly and observing and seeing that you are not this, not that, not this, not that. And then you kind of go, well, then what am I? And then that announces itself. Roberta?
Many years ago, coming out of a very lonely marriage, I was dancing, and dancing helps me free my mind. And I just pop. I'm profoundly lonely. I popped into my head. And I looked around and said, there's everyone else here. And I started this little project. And I said to people, not best friends, who would say they're there now, maybe people I knew very peripherally, I'm profoundly lonely. I expect someone to hit me. No one ever did. Most of them teared up and said, I am too. And I think one of the things that makes us so lonely is that some of us are so good at being other people, or the people other people want us to be, the zealot, that we're zealot instead of ourselves. We're the reflection of what we think others want, rather than our authentic self, which would be more than good enough.
Well, that's pretty much what I'm trying to say. To be your authentic self is what you want to become. And what that is, when you discover it, is so much beyond any personality trait. It's beyond any kind of story or history. Your authentic self is everything you've been searching for in others and in yourself, and it's there. It absolutely reveals itself to you if you get quiet enough and open enough to find it.
Our talent is our self-sabotage. You know, it's that
many people self-sabotage a lot. And I find it amazing to watch it happen. Jim.
Yes, I came off of a 25-year marriage where I couldn't really be honest with my wife. And I was never the person that she always expected me to be. And one of the things I resolved as the marriage dissolved was to purely go forward in an honest manner, being honest with myself and being honest with others, what my expectations are and what my desires are. And it's been extremely uplifting. It's been extremely positive for me. It's made me see the world with a lot more clarity than I had seen before. And I was always trying to be the person that another person expected me to be. And it was just tremendously liberating.
Well, I mean, that's what I was talking about when I talked about meeting you.
Yes.
Because that's exactly the feeling that one gets, that I'm not meeting any kind of presentation.
Right.
I'm just meeting you.
Yes.
And I haven't met a lot of people where I just meet them.
Right.
I mean, you can tell almost immediately when they're doing the song and dance.
Sure.
And you know, if you come to Hollywood,
that's all it is.
Everybody's doing a song and dance. And they don't hear you, they don't listen to you, they're just trying to sell you their shtick. And it's very sad after a while because it's so shallow and insignificant and meaningless.
Sure.
What you want to do is meet people, and when people share their journey with you, you all get to figure out more and more what this extraordinary, unknowable thing is that we're all caught up in. That's the endless mystery.
Yes.
You know, we watch television shows, we watch movies, we go to theater, we read novels, we listen to songs, trying to figure out what is this? And everybody gives a little bit of a hint of it, you know, but the ones we gravitate to are people who speak their truth deeply. People who speak their truth deeply affect us.
And we have to overcome the shame. There is no shame. We have to overcome other people's judgment, and there's no basis for that judgment.
For
the fear of their judgment, there's nothing to fear. Because ultimately, as you said, you know, we are ourselves. And if we're not ourselves, we have nothing.
Come sit here. I mean, that's really, I'm nothing.
Be quite presumptuous of me. I'm still learning to what great about.
It's all the same thing. It's all the same thing. You learn through whatever it is you go through. But if you don't learn, that's the mistake and that's the problem.
Right.
So.
You have like parallel attachment. But one of those agreements is broken because you can't fulfill that person's expectations. And the attachment to the other person is just born. It's a born attachment because that person's born of innocence. And you see them and you see your inability to help them grow. But you know that you have to walk away from this other attachment. And like, I'm trying to develop strategies or just some way to maintain those feelings of attachment to that child, to my child, without feeling obligated to realize this other person's expectations, which may be realistic, but just not for me.
Are you talking about your own children?
Yeah, my child.
Huh? Yeah. A child you have?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, boy oh boy, what a drama. Anyone who has children kind of knows what you're talking about. Children are not yours. And they have their world and they live accordingly.
Mm-hmm.
And they may seem to have passed through your realm for a bit, but they don't necessarily obey your expectations or your rules. And you gotta let them go. You have to let them go. How do you let something you love that deeply go? Well, welcome to 101 of surrender. Because that's what we're all here to learn. And it's the hardest thing in the world. You can let go of things you don't care about. But how do you let go of the stuff you do care about, which ultimately will be your own life, your own breath?
Mm.
If you think you care about your children, wait till they try to take your breath from you.
Mm.
It gets taken away. Here's where you have to give it over to God, or whatever you want to call it. Trust the larger truth of the universe. Surrender. And when you do that, you give it to something that you know through your own inner presence will take care of it. It will. In some cases, it may come back to you in a gentler form. Some cases, it may never come back. Some things are taken away forever. Some things are returned to you in a new form because you were able to let them go. sometimes you hold on and they get worse and worse until everything ruptures. And that's a terrible situation. Life is not an easy journey, but by expressing what you're saying, there's so many people here who have children who know exactly what you're talking about. Even when they have good relationships with their children, they're not yours. They go off. And the job of raising children is freeing them, not holding on to them, not infantilizing them, you know, allowing them to be. And it will rip you apart. That ripping you apart is releasing you from a certain kind of constriction and hold, but it takes an enormous courage to say, thy will be done, as opposed to your will be done. It's hard. But that's the practice. That's really spiritual development or spiritual growth, the willingness to let it go, whether it's taken from you or whether it just wants to leave you. You have to go. Okay. Hard. Anyone else?
I just had a thought. I have two sons. This happens with both of them. Neither one, like maybe 2 years apart. They're on the phone complaining about whatever it is. And so then I give a response, and all of a sudden I hear, pretty annoyed at me, I don't want you to solve it. I just want you to listen.
Yeah.
And then, seriously, 2 years later, he said it a little bit. You're my mother. You don't have to solve it. I just want you to listen. So I guess
that's so important.
And that's when I surrendered. I said,
But let me say that to everybody, including myself. You know, we're not looking for prescriptions.
Exactly.
We are looking for someone to love us and hear us and acknowledge us. That's all we want. And people who offer prescriptions all the time don't hear you. They want to fix you. It's not about being fixed. It's to acknowledge that you are hungry, hurting, in need, and loving them. That's really what it's about. And that's what we need to figure out in time. And when we're trying to make it better for them, we actually tend to make it worse.
It's funny because my older son prefaced it with, you're my mother, I just want you to listen.
Right.
Which is,
well,
I
that.
Want you to love me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes. Well, and don't we all want that? Don't we all want that?
Yeah, having raised 6 children now, their independence is my proudest. If there's an accomplishment, it would be their independence. I revel at how they're able to, go out and experience life each in their own special way. And it hasn't been easy. I mean, I have a transgender child who was rebelling at being me. It was a boy. It was a girl, really, that came out in a boy's body and started looking like me and then rejected me because that's not what she wanted to be. And that was an extremely difficult time.
Well, I'm a parent too, so I my kids they're not as independent as I would like them to be. You know, they have a certain dependence that was created probably by Blanche and I. You know, we made ourselves very available to them, and now we are having to cut the cord every day, a little bit more and a little bit more, and we've waited very long in the game for doing that. But we all have different relationships to this experience, but it's all about the same thing, giving people that independence to be themselves and loving them for that, for what they are. And if we could, what?
It's not only our children.
I can't hear.
It's not only our children. We have to do that to each person that we love. We have to allow them the independence to be with us, straight from us, just be whoever they're going to be.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think
the essence of love is to wish somebody else the best in everything that they do. And it may be distancing themselves from you. Or it's, you know, we don't possess other people. Nobody is chattel to anybody else. And that includes our children.
Yeah, big way. Well, Jim, I love you, and I'm grateful that you've appeared here today. And I love everything you're saying. And Roberta, thank you for bringing him.
Thank you.
Guys, I think we're at the end of this long weekend. You're all tired, I'm tired. You know, it's a lot of effort to get here, it's a lot of effort to go home. And those of you who are here from Denton, it's you got a lot of work ahead. So I really admire and appreciate your effort and your energy in terms of what you're bringing to this space. But anyway, I just thank you all for making the trip, for being here, for sitting through so many classes and so much exchange. Take this with you. You know, there are certain things that others may have said that may have come through me, that may have stuff that erupted with you in dialogues with other people. Let it situate itself, let it marinate itself, let it work itself through you. And we'll be back in October for anybody who cares or is able to be here. If you can't, life goes on wherever you are, and the inner truth of your being is not dependent on place or time. It's just there. Find your way into it whenever you need it, or regularly if you want to just walk around in a state of grace. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.